All right. Well, it's another It's the End of the Week podcast. Thank you, everyone, for joining us. Thank you, Jason Chance, for joining us. Thank you for Christine Mergl joining us. Today, we're going to talk about reporting, Power BI, and all that exciting stuff. So maybe just to get kicked off, I'd like to ask the question, how do these types of projects, these reporting, these Power BI projects typically start?
Yeah, so what I've seen in the past is working with clients is an individual in an organization is tasked with solving a problem. And it's usually something pretty specific that says, hey, we need to report sales by product and by customer. Figure it out. Yeah. And it gets handed to somebody who may or may not know what they're doing. And, you know, Power BI is a relatively easy tool to learn and get started with. And so sometimes that is picked up and people take it and run with it. But what we often see is they maybe solve that one problem well, but don't think about the future and how they can set themselves up for not just solving that one question, but the next 10 questions that are going to come down the line. So that's what Kristen, I'm curious to see if that matches a little bit with your experience or?
Yes, you know. It matched because a lot of managers want to have control of their productivity, their process, and they ask for KPIs or whatever. And we recently added Power BI to our tools in replacement of Tableau. And yeah, there's a lot of demand for tools to follow the productivity of the processes. And there's a lot of teams, like at my workplace, and a lot of teams start like from their like little cells. And like I think as a business, you need to have guidelines with these kind of tools because it can become a monster rapidly. You need to get the data and have consistency in your data.
Yeah. So where does your data come from for the reports?
But we have SAP.
Okay.
We have Astus that create the schedule for the buses.
Okay.
We have a lot of application software where the data is stored.
Okay.
But we have teams that consolidate the data in cubes.
Okay, great.
So lucky for us.
Yeah, that is fantastic. So that means that you've got a whole team devoted to organizing the data, centralizing the data, and working on the consistency and reliability of it. Because for some organizations, a lot of organizations that go down this road are very small, right? It's maybe one person in IT, and the CEO says, hey, IT guy, figure this out, write me some reports, and they just have no idea. And so they don't have a team of people thinking about data consistency, thinking about how do I make this data reusable. And one of the biggest pitfalls we see is, oh, I create, you know, a small data set to make the sales report. And if I had just done a little bit of thinking and planning, maybe I could have incorporated a little bit more information. And now this small data set becomes a little bit bigger, but it becomes much more useful.
Right? Yeah.
And not just to solve one problem, to solve many problems, right?
Yeah, and I would say, you said, well, the manager might ask the IT team to do it. And that's if you're lucky that you're actually asking your IT manager, IT director to think through a strategy. Sometimes it's just going to be asking your solutions analyst or someone working at the firm to say, hey, I heard that Power BI is pretty easy to work with. Could you just build me this report?
Or, hey, you're an accountant. You're good with computers. Why don't you build me this report in Power BI? Right.
Yeah.
We see that all the time.
Exactly, which I think is a misconception on a lot of those low-code, no-code tools where, you know, it's easy to pick up, but it's difficult to scale, to your point.
Yeah. But I had a class last year at the end of the year, and it was a 20-hour class, which we view Power Query, Power Pivot, and Power BI. So 6 hours Power Query, Power Pivot, and the rest for Power BI. And, like, I practice a bit during this period, but I had other project to do and I just get back into it 2 weeks ago. And it's not that easy to get into the tool. Like, I rewatch my recorded classes, formation, and like, it's okay. I can do simple things, but to do like more dig into data things, it will take me a bit more time. And the modeling of the data in the Power BI too, you need to, there are some tricks you need to know just to not lose a lot of time.
Right, and make it easier for people to use, because you might not be the only person building a report. Right?
No,
so you might build a data set for your report, and then someone else says, oh, I'm going to take that data set, I'm going to build my own visuals on top of it.
Yeah.
And if you don't structure the data set in a certain way, it can make it very difficult for someone to understand even what's going on and to navigate the data.
Even yourself when you're building
and you come back 6 months ago, like, you think, wait, what was I thinking? Why did I call it that?
It needs to be really clear when you build a model.
Exactly.
Yeah, and so I'm hearing a lot of, you know, build the data set, different reports, all that kind of stuff. You know, maybe for audience that's not as versed in these different topics, when you say, when you're building a data set, what does that mean?
Yeah, I think so. What we can put up a good visual on the screen about the Power BI architecture. And the nice thing about Power BI is you can use many different sources. So if you, as you look at this visual on the left-hand side, you'll see, you know, they can connect to hundreds of data sources. And you also see on the left-hand side that you're using Power BI Desktop, and that's the main end-user tool to create data sets and create reports. And then everything gets pushed into the Power BI service, which is a cloud-based service. And that's where the report lives, that's where the report runs, and that's where the report can also refresh. And that's another thing that small companies kind of forget or don't really understand. And they think that they have to refresh the report in Power BI Desktop and publish it every day to the Power BI service and just republish it every day. And that's how they refresh the report, which would actually work, but it's much better if you can just put the report in Power BI service and schedule the data set to refresh. But that means that that data has to be accessible to the Power BI service. So it has to be an online source or in SharePoint, in a web page or wherever it comes from, but it has to be accessible online. Or also, if you look at the graphic, if you're gonna use on-premise data sources, so in your own data center in your company, you have to set up a Power BI gateway so that the Power BI service in the cloud can talk to your databases on-premise and pull data from there and load it into data sets. So that's a lot for an accountant, right,
to handle
and to set up if it's not very simple and straightforward, right? And on top of that, so once you get the Power BI service, you get the data and the initial report set up, now that's how everyone accesses those reports, either through a mobile device, tablet, computer, whatever it is. And folks can just hop on the Power BI service and generate their own visuals if they have the right access to develop their own dashboards, to develop their own reports based on maybe the data that you set up and provided.
And as you said, you need to have a license, because if not, you need to have a license to access, dans le fond, the Power BI application.
Right.
If not, and for us, it's kind of the case, not every user has access. So you need to generate like a PDF, PowerPoint, whatever, other documents to share.
And distribute it.
Yeah, to distribute the information. And you cannot dig into the
PDF document. Yeah,
that's it. It's just a report.
Yeah.
So until every user has the license, they cannot view the...
Or, interact with it. And, you know, if I take a bit of a step back and I try to recap what you said, is the idea is that, you know, Microsoft and these other companies that push these reporting tools out in a way that they're saying, hey, this is very easy to adapt and this is very easy to deploy, it is true to a certain extent, but you can't necessarily skip the step of defining the strategy in which you want to deploy this in your organization and understand what your data structure is. Once that is done, then that is true that someone could easily add a field, change a visual, do these different elements. But to me, one thing that sometimes, you know, people don't necessarily understand when they don't have to understand the knowledge with these reporting tools, and that there's really the data sets, the data structure, the data layer, and then there's all the individual reports. And the data sets, the data structure is something that, that still remains an IT function to this day, to a certain extent, right? Or a developer's function or someone that's very quite technical versus then what you can give to your accountant, what you can give to the other team members
to create
is
their report.
Creating their reporting and doing those different types of elements. So if you were to, if you had the chance or the opportunity to speak to anyone saying, hey, if you want to get invested in these kind of technologies or you want to think about starting reporting, we talked about the pitfalls. What are the kind of things that you should do or how should you plan to go about it? And how should you even put governance on these type of technologies?
Yeah. So the best thing to do is to usually start out how people start out, where they're trying to solve one problem or they're focused on one set of data. For a lot of organizations that we work with, that's typically sales. That tends to be like some of the most important data that they want to crack open first. So great, let's get the sales data in into the Power BI so we can analyze it. But then the question you have to ask is, what granularity do we need the data? Do we need to go down to the day? If I'm at a retail location, do I need the time of day of each sale? Right? Am I going to that level? What about product level detail? Do I go down to the product itself? Do I only analyze it at the product group? What about the customer? Do I analyze each individual customer or just maybe groups of customers or customer tiers? Right? You have to answer all of those questions of how am I going to use the data to solve the question that's in front of me, but also how am I going to solve the next question that comes in front of me? Because a lot of times you'll say like, oh, I just need a sales report for product group and customer tier. That's all I need. And if you just build the data at that level, then that's all that's there. That's all the level of detail that you have. And as soon as someone says like, oh, that number's weird on that product group, let's dive into that and figure out why that number's weird. You're like, well, the data, I can't dive into that because the data stops right there, right? So, but if you've built it to have that level of detail and you're just showing it rolled up at the product group level, great. Now you can just drill in, look at the details, and be able to solve that next question that comes in. So, yeah, that's the approach I would take. But then also you have to think about, all right, now I've set this up. What is now dependent on this data that I've created, right? Maybe I'm the first one to write a report, but now maybe there's other salespeople who are using a report. Maybe there's other visuals that, I don't know, someone else created because they have a Power BI license. And now we've got this little ecosystem that's now dependent on the data that I created.
Yes.
What's the maintenance involved in this? And who's monitoring this, right? If this is a critical function, that salesperson goes out to a customer and they don't have up-to-date data, can they do their job? Does it impact them directly? That means that you really need to monitor this, and it has to be someone's responsibility to know that the data refreshed, it was successful, and it's been validated, right? That's something that's often skipped, is the maintenance involved and who's taking that on.
If you are building a set of data for sales and maybe another department use the same data source, but manipulated differently, it can give two different results for the same desire to show the same results.
Yeah, we've had this, and this is one of the worst things that you can do is to have two sources of the truth, and then you say, all right, what was my sales in July? Oh, it was this number. Oh, I got this number. And as soon as you have two different numbers for the sales in July, people don't trust it.
Yeah, that's it.
Right. And so as soon as they don't trust it, like you just lost their trust, and it takes a while to get that back and be like, nope, the data's good now. We validated it. And I've definitely had that happen before. So you have to be very careful about having multiple sources of the truth.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So. And I think that kind of rolls into an interesting point when we always talk about change management when deploying technology. And to your point, if people start looking at reports and they're getting different sources of truth, different numbers for sources of truth, you lose confidence in the technology you're deploying. So by trying to undermine the effort, the strategy to deploy these kind of reports, you might actually be losing your opportunity of doing a proper deployment and having people adopt it. And, you know, what I've seen, and I mean, Christine and Jason, please talk to me about that. But what I've seen is people tend to just use Power BI report, extract the data, and then just run their Excel spreadsheets next to it because they're going to try to see how they could get that number or how they're able to get the additional information they want. And then you're not getting user adoption, which you want to do by having this tool deployed. So as we think through that, like, what would you say is a way to solve for that, or what is this something that people should just think about whenever, you know, ensuring one source of truth?
Yeah, so the main thing is to have someone take ownership of it, right? And so if it's a sales data set, someone from sales needs to own that data and own that it's correct, and they have to take that on. And that means that as you're building it, they have to test it, and you have to test it different ways and slice it and dice it different ways and make sure those slices match exactly what you expect, right? And then does it need to tie out to something in accounting, right? So we might be pulling sales data from a different source than our accounting data that hits our general ledger. Those two have got to tie out, because as soon as you put a number up there in front of the CFO that's different than the number that's in the general ledger, the CFO is going to be like, that's garbage, doesn't match, my number's correct, right? And that's end of discussion right there. So.
Would you suggest to think of a big picture structure of like workspace and layers of workspace? I don't know. I watched a couple of videos about that. And you can have layers of workspace, one that is more back end, like test, development, everything, or data set that is shared after that to another layer, more to for the user.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So what you're referring to specifically is our Power BI workspaces, which are, you can think of them like as containers or folders or areas where you put reports and data sets, and then you can control access to each workspace individually. Right? And so a great example you just gave is, you know, for developers, when we're developing these, we create a development workspace, and we're the only ones that get in there because we're just trying stuff out and testing it out, and we don't want an end user to stumble upon a development report and the number's not good and the data's not good. So that's a great example. And then creating a test workspace is a fantastic practice. Very few people do it, but it's a great idea because as you're rolling out changes, you need to do that validation and do that ownership and say that, yes, this report is good. The next version of this report is good. We're going to test it fully, and then we're going to move it in production, and we're going to inform everyone who's involved that this change just went into production, so let us know if anything looks strange or whatever. And have that rigor. But that's a great use of workspaces in Power BI, is to divide up dev, test, and production. For sure.
And I feel like we're going through the same motions with these no-code, low-code tools as we went through 15, 20 years ago whenever we started building and developing business software more at scale, right? Where you look back 15, 20 years ago and people weren't testing warehouse management systems before deploying to prod. They were just building them, deploying them, and figuring that out.
Right.
You tell that to someone today that's getting into deploying warehouse management systems or ERPs or anything like that, they would say, well, that's unconceivable. That's insane to do that. But we learned, right? Yeah. We said, well, actually, no, this is the framework. You go from dev to test, production, and even to QA whenever there's updates and that kind of stuff, right? So now it's a given. But because you have integration partners that know this and are able to easily inform end users and end clients that that's how it should be done, then this isn't a hurdle or not as much anymore versus these low-code, no-code tools whenever you start playing around with them like Power BI, Power Automate, the different suite. Yeah. Because it's so easy to have access to those tools and kind of play around with it, sometimes we try to take shortcuts. And when we try to take shortcuts, well, that's when we can, unfortunately, have these challenges. And you know, kind of brings me to a point where you know, sometimes managers don't understand the effort that's required to even get these up and running and maintaining them and all that kind of stuff. And I think it's important to for end users that are building these reports, and maybe you could talk to that a bit, but to really provide the feedback to your team and provide the feedback to your managers of what is the investment of time that it takes to actually get that done.
Yeah, that's a lot of effort, I would say, because yes, it's a low code, but there's a lot of technicality and specificity that you need to know By example, if you want to connect, I don't know if you had the, for sure, maybe you forgot about this because you're so used to it, but just an example, when you want to connect to a folder, if you connect to an Excel files on your server on-premise, it always add your name in the beginning. So if after that you share it, like the other people will not have access because of this little like specificity, it adds your name before. So you need to do a web link and put it on SharePoint, by example. And you need, when you do it, you need to erase the last few characters. Like it's small things like that you can lose time in the beginning.
Well, they do those things to make it easy for you to implement it, right? And
yeah,
make it seamless. But then when
you
want
to know it.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. But then when you want to actually put it out there and refresh it on a schedule, if that dash Christine file is not available, it's going to fail. Right?
That's it. So there's like small things like that you can find in Excel too. Like there's the format, this kind of thing. But
Yeah, and it's interesting because when you look at the different tools, you know, and we're using Microsoft as an example here, but you look at different tools for Microsoft, and you look at the skill set that's required to start leveraging those tools, you know, these low-code, no-code tools have the greatest bandwidth of types of people that we could use it. So someone that has very little knowledge of, in technology or just programming could actually start using them. But you could go all the way to a deep level of programming in those tools. So the subset of people that could and should interact with that tool is very, very large if you compare, let's say, to PowerPoint, to Excel, or to these other tools of Microsoft, which there's just less, the audience is much more restrained.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah, and that can lead to all sorts of challenges.
Yeah, and to be efficient, another thing is that, because I had a class, and it's to use the DAX language, by example.
Yeah.
And, like, it's not that easy to
No, it's not.
In the beginning, at least, to get used to these languages to make calculation, the measure.
Right.
The measure. So, yes, but I will get used to it.
Yeah, and that's the thing. Like, DAX is the query language you can use within Power BI datasets.
Yeah.
It's super powerful.
It's super powerful.
Yeah, but it's the syntax of it is like nothing else. It's,
yeah,
it's its own beast,
yes,
and you have to learn it and just have to understand it. And it's
I would say it's, you know, I think these tools are fantastic. You know, if you think Power BI, if you think Tableau, if you think of all the other reporting tools that we use, they're great tools. I think sometimes the only problem is that there's a misperception of how these should be implemented in business and who should take ownership of what step of it. So, you know, I think the goal today was really just kind of talk through some of these things, some of these challenges, and just give some insight of what we've learned, of what Christine learned at her job implementing this from an end user point of view. Do you have any, you know, kind of last closing remarks?
Well, I would just say that, you know, if you are listening from home and your manager has tasked you with, you know, getting a report to him by Friday because it's so easy, and I saw this video online, and why can't we just have this report by Friday? Maybe just send him a link to this podcast and, you know, give him a little dash of reality about what's really involved and how to do it well.
So. All right. Well, thank you very much for
thank
your time.
You.
Yeah.
And thanks, everyone, for listening. Have a great week.
Thanks.
Have a great week.